Mr. President, I rise today in strong support of the 9/11 Health and Compensation Act. Now, yesterday we observed Pearl Harbor Day, marked the 69th anniversary of that tragic attack on American soil. 9 years ago, our nation was attacked once again. September 11, 2001, was a day of indescribable horror, not only for New York, the city I'm proud to call home, but for the entire nation. In the minutes, hours, and days after the Twin Towers collapsed, thousands of first responders rushed to Lower Manhattan to dig through the rubble. First, they searched for survivors. We all remember the horrible, this is vivid in my mind, Mr. President, the signs people were holding. Have you seen this person? It's my husband, my wife, my child, my parent. Because no one knew where everyone was amidst the rubble. And we thought, unfortunately, we were disappointed deeply, that there were survivors amidst the rubble, and time was of the essence to find them. Then, in days later, when we realized that there weren't many survivors, there was still a great need to sadly search for the bodies of those who perished. You can imagine the anguish of families who wanted a sign, something, remains of their loved ones, and that search continued. Valiant men and women, not just from New York or New Jersey or Connecticut, but from Minnesota and Colorado and all around the country, came, firefighters, first responders, police officers, ordinary citizens, to help us in our horrible hour of need, a moment, a day, a week, a month, that I will never forget. I still look out my window of my home in Brooklyn every day when I'm home and note that those two twin towers are no longer there, and I think of the people I knew who were lost. A guy I played basketball with in high school, a businessman who helped me on the way up, a firefighter who dedicated his life for my neighborhood in Brooklyn where I was raised to helping get people to donate blood. So we think of all these people. They were resolute, they were brave, they were selfless, those who were lost, and then those who came to the rubble. Construction workers. They didn't ask if they were going to get paid. They didn't ask what the danger was to them. They were brave, they were resolute, they were selfless, as were firefighters, policemen, EMTs, and others. Amidst the chaos and the carnage, they said to themselves, "This is what I am trained for, and I will do whatever it takes to help, even if it means risking my life." Though the dust has settled, and the ruins of the World Trade Center have been cleared away, the effect of the attacks are still being felt now more than ever by thousands of those first responders. Medical experts have determined that on September 11th and the days after, the air around Ground Zero was filled with microscopic cement and glass particles. This dust has caused thousands of first responders to develop chronic respiratory and gastrointestinal diseases. Just last week, we lost 9/11 first responder Kevin Chartoriski, an NYPD, a New York Police narcotics detective. He's the third hero to pass away in the past month from the medical complications related to the rescue effort. Back in 2006, doctors from the Mount Sinai Medical Center that my predecessor, or my former colleague, now Secretary of State, then Senator Clinton, worked so hard to bring into the picture, found that a staggering 70% of 9/11 rescue workers suffered from health problems, many of which were irreversible. And the fact is, Mr. President, right now there are people who rush to those towers who don't know that they're ill. The symptoms of these illnesses and diseases, when you get these particles in your lungs and in your gastrointestinal system, the cancers and other illnesses that develop take years and years before they can be detected. So we know that in the coming years, there are going to be more heroes who will become ill, and those who are already suffering may see their conditions worsen. The 9/11 Health and Compensation Act will finally put these first responders at ease with the knowledge that they'll receive treatment for health problems related to rescuing victims of the attack and helping clear the debris from Ground Zero. The bill ensures that those at risk of illness have access to medical monitoring and that all those who get sick from exposure have a right to consistent treatment. The bill also ensures ongoing data collection and analysis for exposed populations so we can try to cure or treat in advance people who might become ill. And critically, the legislation would ensure steady funding for these vital programs so that those in treatment no longer have to wonder whether or not Congress will appropriate adequate funds to allow their treatment to continue year to year. We have appropriated funds every year. Everyone in this chamber has voted for those funds. But when it's yearly funds and you need an ongoing medical regime, it's very hard to plan, to buy that machine, to set up a team that would work for 3 or 4 or 5 years under normal circumstances. The heroes who rushed to the towers deserve to be guaranteed proper treatment, not to have their medical needs subject to the whims of what's going on at that month, that time in Washington. And let me say this. In addition to addressing health needs, the bill would reopen the Victims Compensation Fund, allowing those who missed the arbitrary deadline of December 22, 2003 to seek compensation. This deadline's unfairly barred responders who became ill or learned of the fund after the date. You rushed to the tower. As of 2003, you were aware of the fund. But you didn't apply, you didn't have anything wrong with you, and 6 months later you get cancer of the lungs or cancer of the esophagus or stomach, which we found so many getting. Why unfairly prevent them? So, Mr. President, this bill is an opportunity to send a clear message to the thousands of first responders who risked their lives on that fateful day 9 years ago. We say to them, in our nation's time of need, you gave us your all. Now, in your time of need, we will give you our all. Let's not forget, on both sides of the aisle, we have mightily struggled to help our veterans from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. In 2001 and 2002, we saw that veterans' health care was not up to snuff, and there was a bipartisan effort to bring it up to snuff, to make the health care adequate for the new needs of the veterans who risked their lives for us in Iraq and Afghanistan. Why? Because this nation has a tradition. When you volunteer, as our soldiers do today, and risk your life to protect our freedom, particularly at a time of war, we will be there for you and deal with your medical problems that were caused in that conflict. I would argue to every one of my colleagues here today, those who rushed to the towers in those fateful hours and days after 9/11 are no different than our veterans who we exalt. It was a time of war. Our nation was attacked. They volunteered. No one compelled them to do it. And they rushed to danger like our veterans do. So when they are injured, which has happened, they should be treated the same as our veterans. This is nothing we should play politics with, just like we don't play politics with veterans' needs. I want to make sure that everybody hears us. I know there's other legislative concerns, whether it's tax bills or funding bills or whatever. I would say to my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, it is not fair and it is not right to say we will not remember these people who volunteered and risked their lives to protect our freedom in a time of war. We will not help them until X or Y or Z gets done. Not fair, not right. It is also time for those who are against this bill to stop spreading lies about it. They say it's vulnerable to fraud. It's been very tight. My good colleague, the senator from New York, Senator Gillibrand, has documented thoroughly and completely how the existing compensation has not created any fraud or other types of problems. And so, we're here. We've debated this bill for years. It's been like running a marathon, and this is the last 100 yards. Thousands of first responders, police officers, firefighters, construction workers, and other heroes who are ordinary citizens from each of the 50 states, is waiting for us to act. And for all too many of them, help cannot come soon enough. The finish line is in view. Let us, on both sides of the aisle, cross it together. I implore my colleagues to vote in favor of the 9/11 Health and Compensation Act. And before I sit down, I just want to praise my colleague who has led the fight on this, Senator Gillibrand from New York. She has made it her passion. She works for it hours every day and has done an amazing, amazing job. And I also want to thank our other colleagues on this legislation, particularly my colleagues from across the river, Senators Lautenberg and Menendez, who have been our partners in this. I want to thank Peter King, Carolyn Maloney, Gerald Nadler in the House for their work, and many others in the New York and other delegations. And again, hope that those efforts will not go in vain, not because of the people who worked on the bill like we did, but because of the people who need our help, like those who have all kinds of illnesses, because they volunteered to help our great nation and preserve its freedom in a time of war. I yield the floor.